Everyone, today we'll be talking about Burkitt's lymphoma. Burkitt's lymphoma refers to an aggressive type of B-cell non-Hodgkin's lymphoma that occurs most often in children and young adults. The disease may affect the jaw, central nervous system, bowel, kidneys, ovaries, or other organs. So there are three types of Burkitt's lymphoma. There's African, which we also call endemic. There's sporadic, which is non-endemic, and aggressive lymphoma occurring in HIV patients. We also refer to this type as aggressive lymphoma in immunocompromised patients. So histologically, all the three types are identical. However, the genotype and virology is different. So endemic type of Burkitt's lymphoma is seen among young children of Equatorial Africa. It frequently affects the jaw of children with developing molar teeth. Experts suggest that growth factors may be responsible for the site-specific nature of this tumor. So you can see in this image, so Burkitt's lymphoma affecting the jaw, unilateral jaw involvement. Sporadic Burkitt's lymphoma. So this often involves the abdomen and it spreads to the bone marrow in about 20% of patients. When Burkitt's lymphoma involves the abdomen, it can cause symptoms such as abdominal pain, swelling, nausea, vomiting, and changes in bowel habit. It's a highly malignant lymphoma, but it is potentially curable with very aggressive therapy. So basically, sporadic mainly involves the abdomen. So you can see here in the diagram, so it's Burkitt's lymphoma affecting the abdomen. And then it metastasizes to the bone marrow in about 20% of patients. So basically, everyone in 5 patients that has sporadic Burkitt's lymphoma will have metastasis to the bone marrow. Immunodeficient Burkitt's lymphoma. So this affects patients with abnormal or suppressed immune systems, such as patients with HIV. So here you can see Burkitt's lymphoma affecting the jaw unilaterally. Here it's affecting the jaw bilaterally. It's affecting the abdomen, it's affecting the eye, it's affecting the breast. Pathogenesis. All forms of Burkitt's lymphoma are associated with the translocation of the CMYC gene on chromosome 8. So EBV is found in all African Burkitt's lymphomas and 25% of the HIV-associated Burkitt lymphomas, but it's rare in an endemic or sporadic type of Burkitt's. So in African Burkitt's lymphoma, EBV is found in all patients. And HIV-associated Burkitt's lymphoma is found in 25% of patients. And in non-endemic Burkitt's lymphoma, it's rarely seen. So EBV in itself, it does not appear to be the only factor in causing the development of Burkitt's lymphoma. Thus, not everyone who gets infected with EBV develops Burkitt's lymphoma. So you may have EBV but not develop Burkitt's lymphoma, okay? So pathogenesis. So once you get EBV, there'll be shedding of EBV, isn't it? Then that's going to go and affect your B cells. That will be polyclonal B cell activation. Now that's going to lead to African Burkitt's lymphoma. So if we look at the target organs affected, if it affects the brain, it leads to encephalitis. It affects the lymph nodes, lymphadenitis. Skin to lead to a rash. Liver, hepatitis. Spleen, splenomegaly. Okay, so other associated causes of Burkitt's lymphoma. Chronic malaria infection has been identified as one of the core factors for the development of Burkitt's lymphoma, since it favors sustained proliferation of B cells immortalized by EBV. Then a weakened immune system fails to control EBV infection and thus favors proliferation of the infected cells, and thus the high incidence of EBV-associated Burkitt's lymphoma in immunocompromised patients. So the common sets that involve are the bones, kidneys, GI tract, ovaries, breast, at the extranodal sites. Then bilateral involvement of the breast may occur in association with onset of puberty or with lactation. And lymph node involvement is more common among adults than among children. Patients may also have malignant pleural effusions or ascites. Staging. So group A is low risk. This is where there's a single facial mask that excludes retroorbital masses less than 10 centimeters. Group B is high risk. That is any disease more than group A but without CNS disease. then group C is CNS disease is present. So any child with clinical or lab evidence of CNS disease associated with any other stage of Burkitt's lymphoma disease, all retroorbital masses are considered as high risk for CNS disease and therefore included in this group. So basically under CNS disease, we also include retroorbital masses. Then group D is bone marrow involvement. Any child with lab evidence of bone marrow involvement associated with any other stage of Burkitt's lymphoma disease. So one is A is single facial mass less than 10 centimeters, B, basically any disease in group A but without any CNS disease. Then group C affects the CNS, also retroorbital masses. Then group D is bone marrow involvement. So investigation required are clinical investigation, radiological investigation, cytology. Then these are some other investigations. We can do serology for HIV. Remember, because we have HIV associated Burkitt's lymphoma, you can do ultrasound scan of the swelling, CSF examination, renal function test, electrolytes, bone marrow aspirate, and biopsy. So under management, we have got chemotherapy, radiation, and surgery. So under chemotherapy, it's the treatment of choice. Alternative name is cytotoxic drugs. So chemotherapy uses anti-cancer drugs that are given IV, IT, or orally. These drugs enter the bloodstream and each all areas of the child's body, making this treatment useful for cancer that has spread widely. So chemotherapy drugs include cyclophosphamide, vincristine, methotrexate. Surgery. So surgery should not be done simply to remove a tumor, as normal organs might be damaged in the process. Other reasons for surgery include to obtain tissue for diagnostic tests when other procedures could not obtain enough tissue. On an emergency basis to relieve a blockage, such as if there's obstruction in the intestine caused by the tumor mass. Radiation. It was once the main treatment for children with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. However, it is no longer used in the initial treatment of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, except perhaps in an emergency to treat pressure on the trachea. So for it can also be used for palliation during late presentation. Side effects of our chemotherapy, we've got nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, loss of appetite, alopecia, then tumor lysis syndrome, which usually occurs after a rapid destruction of the tumor, which leads to hyperuricemia that will lead to renal failure. So you can prevent this is by allopurinol, which helps in excretion of our uric acid and have plenty of fluids. Then breakdown products may affect kidney, heart, CNS. Damage to other normal cells that are dividing rapidly, such as bone marrow, linings of mouth, GIT, reproductive cells, yet hemorrhagic cystitis. They can also be cardiotoxic, and vincristine is neurotoxic. So for prognosis, International Prognostic Index, it was designed to further classify the lymphoma staging. So IPI predicts the risk of disease recurrence and overall survival by taking into account factors such as age, stage of disease, general health, number of extranodal sites, presence or absence of an elevated serum enzyme named lactate dehydrogenase. So under differential diagnosis of abdominal masses, we've got Wilms tumor, neuroblastoma, hepatoblastoma, and differential diagnosis for splenomegaly includes sequestration crisis and sickle cell disease, severe complicated malaria, leukemias. So that's all about Burkitt's lymphoma. Thank you.